this every year that I've been on city council, even before that, has had this kind of back and forth with the school board in terms of funding. And really, that's not an appropriate way to handle funding for schools. And when we get to that stage that we're talking about closing schools in May due to budget shortfalls, it's really a terrible conversation to have. And it's creating more strife for our community, our parents, and our students, particularly at times they're going into their testing season. So one thing that I would argue is that we do need to come up with a formula of sorts that would determine how much funding is needed. If you look at what the school board and Dr. Bennett have been working on, they basically have been looking at the standards of quality and taking the state level standard of quality, but bringing it into what is Richmond standard of quality. How much funding do we need for schools when we've got poverty rates, et cetera. In terms of dedicated funding, I think that we can look at percentage, whether it's the total budget, whether it's from expanding on the percentage that the schools receive from the meals tax. But for me, I also create a dedicated funding stream in council approved, so anytime the school surplus property, they get the real estate taxes specifically from those properties.
I personally support dedicating the meals tax, all of the meals tax revenues directly to the operations and maintenance of the school system. And Rico County already does this. They have money in the garden for years in terms of capital improvement projects. But what I also believe we need to do is that whoever gets elected to city council and mayor needs to be willing to go down to the General Assembly and demand that they review the local composite index and demand answers for their misuse of Virginia lottery funds, which were meant to be used as a boost to school funding. Over the past 10 years, we haven't had a city council that has been willing to go across the street to the General Assembly and demand those answers. And I think it's about time that we start.
Yeah, thank you. So every year the city council and school board develop a legislative package. And we sit down with our legislators and we go over the legislative package. And every year that I've been on city council, we say we want to change the local composite index. And our state legislators, the delegates and state senators, are telling us they can't get it passed. So it's not that city council isn't going and demanding this. It's really the fact that we've got a state that is controlled at the General Assembly by people who don't have Richmond's interest first. That's where we've got to develop regional interest with people from Northern Virginia and from Southwest Virginia and California.
I would like to also say this. I'm going to give that to your credit, but I will also say that perhaps we need to support John Delisle's plan, which is the Roanoke 40 plan, to dedicate 40% of all taxes total directly to the Roanoke schools.
Okay, thank you. Our next question. The homicide rate is very high this year. Theft and break-ins are common problems. What steps would you take to turn things around at this time of the year, Mr. Magruder?
I personally believe that the issues involving crime all stem from the fact that we have an economic and political system that prioritizes and values profit over human life. When you have a government that focuses on all these profit-making schemes, on building fancy bus lines, on building training camps for football teams, in some cases, some of the wealthiest football teams in the nation, then you will see the upticks in crime because there's no investments there. I mean, if just imagine how different things would be if everybody had a house to live in, if people had decent food to eat, were able to afford their water bills and whatnot and their electricity without having to break the bank, if they were able to have access to health care and decent mass transportation. Just imagine how different things would be if those dynamics were in place instead of us focusing on making millions of dollars from people drinking a cup of water.
So I think the question was more about how do we make our community safer. And one thing that I know for sure right now is that the number of theft of auto vehicles is on the spike here. A lot of that comes to basically how do we all operate in the city of Richmond. I know I leave stuff all spread out in my car. The Richmond police are constantly reminding people, put your junk in your trunk, right? Crimes occur because we do stupid things to allow the crimes to occur.
That's not true. This is such a bad answer.
Richmond Police Department is down in the number of officers that it has. I think we need to do a better job of staffing the police, but the problem is we are spending tons of money to train officers only to have them recruited elsewhere, right? We need to adopt a little bit more of a non-compete with the surrounding counties so that when we're making the investment in our law enforcement, that they're not getting recruited in the surrounding counties. Just this morning, I was at the Regional Planning District Commission, and then we had Hanover, Goochland, Powhatan, New Kent, and Charles City all saying how their fire departments are going to be having to leave from a volunteer program, and they're going to need to start ramping up and staffing paid fire departments. Well, guess where they're going to start recruiting? They're going to come to City of Richmond and take our fire department. We train them. So we need to make sure that we
can. Well, in order to get to the original point, my thing is this. Like I said earlier, we live in a system where profit is valued over human life. And that's what I believe is the main economic driver of crime. Because when you look at all the statistics, the crimes are mainly done because of economic reasons. People are trying to survive. People don't have the means to survive. People are consistently shut out of the means to be able to survive, so they turn to crime. They turn to prostitution, they turn to drugs. How about we actually value human life over profit, and then we can go ahead and actually address crime? What I find most problematic about the Redskins training camp deal is that when the deal was, and correct me if I'm wrong on any of this, when the deal was originally negotiated, they did not have a clause stating that the city would pay the Redskins $500,000 a year. That was inserted after the deal was approved. So what they wanted, so basically the city at its own insistence said, oh, here you go, Redskins, we'll give you $500,000 a year just to come here for like 3 weeks a year. And on top of that, there was supposed to be parts of the deal like the Montigue building that did not materialize. So it seems like to me, like the Redskins and some of these other entities that were involved in the deal did not hold up their fair share. And so I think it's about time, and I agree with Mr. Agelasto, we need to renegotiate that deal. And I believe this starts by removing that clause requiring us to pay $500,000 a year to the second wealthiest team in the NFL.
$500,000 in year one and said we're going to get it every each year. to say I don't have the time, but they wouldn't even recognize our law enforcement as an in-kind service to make sure that that facility was safe and that the players who came, the celebrities who came and needed additional security personnel, they didn't even recognize that city expenditure as in-kind.
So we're
going. Okay, thank you. Let's talk potholes. What's your specific plan and time frame to address potholes, uneven road surfaces, and grass cutting throughout the city? And this time we will begin with Mr. Magruder.
I do believe we do need to address the pothole issue. Mainly, that's where we have all the problems with the infrastructure. Grass cutting, yes, it's a health issue, but we need to take that. That needs to be put on the back burner for right now. Mainly because, and I'm speaking as a person who rides a scooter. I have ridden a whole bunch of roads that have a bunch of potholes in them. Basically, it's tantamount to free birth control for men, if you get what I mean. And so I do believe that first we need to have a comprehensive audit, and I've called for an audit within the first 90 days of me taking office. I'm willing to do that. So that way we can actually identify the money that would be necessary so that we can go ahead and pay over all these potholes.
The first thing that we have to do is actually fill vacancies in public works. Currently, the crews that are doing potholes are also the same crews that are doing bulk and brush collection that are also being pulled from our solid waste unit, that are also the ones who are out there cutting grass. I mean, we just don't have the personnel that the public works department needs at this time. The other thing I would say in terms of the potholes is it is smart to do a blitz and to basically have a unit that's going around geographically to work on them. But the issue is, and this is where the citizen's responsibility comes in, we need everybody to report it. Like, the city isn't omnipotent, they don't know where every pothole is. And so we need the citizens to do their part to report them. The other thing that I will say on the potholes is when you report them and then you have a car damage, the city pays out a claim for your car damage, right? The city has been paying out millions of dollars in claims. So it's a better investment for us to fix those potholes. As for grass cutting, I did some a turnaround day where I actually did grass cutting with city staff. There's efficiencies within that department that we need to do. Basically, they send out a team with grass cutters, weed treaters, etc., and they've got eight guys who are all on different equipment who are operating at different speeds. And some guys finish quickly, and other guys still need about 30 minutes more, and we've got people just waiting around for the remainder of the crew to finish up. So there are operational efficiencies to put in place.
I think the main reason why we may not have enough staff in our maintenance department is mainly because we may not be offering attractive pay and benefits that would be satisfactory to the people that may want to work for the city. And so I propose that if it is possible that we raise the wage of all city workers, contractors, and subcontractors to $23 an hour, which is what it should be, given all economic factors such as increased worker productivity and increased cost of living.
So the city council, while I have been serving for the last 4 years, we actually adopted a living wage policy. It pays every city employee a minimum of $11.38. The problem that we're having with public works is that we have temped it out. There are too many jobs that we've temped out, and we're paying temp agencies $15 for an employee. The temp agency is taking $5, the employee gets 10. These are problems that we're having. We're not retaining the proper personnel, largely because we haven't put them into our employment system in the appropriate way. And I think if we actually put them as full-time employees, we're going to get better morale.
Some officials have talked about raising taxes to shore up schools or other budgetary shortfalls. Would you raise taxes to solve any of these problems? And this time we're going to begin with Mr. Agelasto.
You can call me Parker. And you can go into all my material, everything is big red as Parker. Just call me Parker. So in terms of the taxes, I'm not a big fan of increasing taxes. I know that the mayor proposed increasing taxes. I think first we rate for real estate property tax has fallen to 94%. The surrounding counties are at 99%. For every 1% that the city does better at collecting on the current real estate property taxes, that's $2.5 million into the annual operating budget. If we get 5% to match the county ratio, it's $10 million. It's $10 million that we currently don't have in our operating budget. If we do better at that, then we don't have to raise the taxes on those who are already currently paying a very high rate.
Could you repeat the question, please?
Some officials have talked about raising taxes to shore up schools or to shore up other budgetary shortfalls. Would you raise taxes to solve any of these problems?
No. I do not support, for example, I will not support increasing the property tax. I do believe that John Belisle actually put out a brief about how we can actually have some efficiencies without having to raise taxes at all. And I think we need to go ahead with those recommendations they set forth, especially the ones pertaining to the recommendations that came from the city auditor. I do believe that we perhaps could have maybe a cigarette tax, because we're the only locality in the state that doesn't have one.
Yes.
And so that way we can actually have a dedicated funding source to fund public transit operations. Because again, we're one of the biggest localities that doesn't have such a source.
So, Montigue, Magruder, you're right. The city doesn't have a cigarette tax. In fact, we are the only city that doesn't have one. Ashland has one. Petersburg has one. Ashland gets about $350,000 a year from your cigarette tax, and it hasn't hurt anybody from Hanover or anybody else visiting Ashland. I wouldn't say that that's a terrible idea, but I think you do have to be very cognizant that Altria is the single largest taxpayer to the city of Richmond today. And you have to assess what they would potentially do if you had that in place. But I think it's certainly worth having a conversation about
that. Well, I think that the conversation needs to be had with the people. And so I support, if we're not going to have a cigarette tax, I support it by at least letting us have a public referendum on it. So that way, ultimately, the people can decide whether we will have a cigarette tax in this town or not.
And I don't disagree with that referendum.
The relationships among elected and administrative bodies in Richmond have been contentious. They've been marked by lack of communication and distrust. What do you believe has caused this, and what is your solution to mend relationships and work to begin with Richmond? The relationships among elected and administrative bodies in Richmond have been contentious and marked by a lack of communication and mistrust. What do you believe has caused this, and what is your solution to mend these relationships?
Well, I think what needs to happen is that when there's meetings going on, like, for example, school board meetings and city council meetings, I think the representatives from each of the districts need to be present. For example, if the school board is having a meeting, why won't the city council person be present at those meetings? I mean, that's what it comes down to.
So a couple of thoughts on this, and I'll come back to a rebuttal from all of you, but you do need collaboration, you need open communication, you need somebody that you can go to and feel like the conversation that you're having is really an honest one. What I have found is that too often we're having private conversations, and I can have a private conversation with person one and then a second conversation with person two and give them completely different responses. And by the time the person one talks to person two, they're totally confused about where I stand. We need to have a lot more of our discussions open publicly, even if it means that we might be revealing biases, even if it means that we have to do more of a thinking in public. This is government. We need open and transparency in our leadership so that people know what we're thinking and how we're representing them. Secondly, we need a mayor who will sit down with council members. I've served on the city council for 4 years. I've sat down with Mayor Jones twice in 4 years. That is not the way you develop partnerships to run a city. For the mayoral candidates, contacted me back in April and May, and we sat down. They wanted to know how could we work together. to have the school board come to formal city council meetings, and the city council go to the formal school board meetings. They happen at the same time on Monday nights. It's just impossible. But I do think that we should have a regular sit-down lunch appointment so that both bodies can get together.
In terms of your last point, I think maybe we need to reschedule those meetings entirely. So that way they're not running at the same time. And perhaps we should also reschedule them so that they're not scheduled where people are just getting home from work and having sit down and have a dinner going on with their children. We need to reschedule them so that it's actually more people friendly.
Okay. The city provides water and gas to Henrico. However, their rates are significantly lower than those in the city. Will you commit to charging Richmond residents the actual cost without the large markups that subsidize other operations? And we're going to begin with Parker.
I think I understand your question to not necessarily talk about Henrico's rates, but to really talk about the provision that is in the city charter that addresses what would be called payment in lieu of taxes that the city residents pay, and that Henrico residents also pay. Frankly, this is something that I've looked into for the last 4 years. I've asked for legal opinions. I've asked for Attorney General of the State of Virginia to look at it and see whether or not it is in fact legal to collect federal income taxes and have those paid to the city of Richmond. I haven't gotten a response. I enlisted Senator Watkins at one point to try and get this done. It's still a big issue. I think that the city needs to evaluate it and to really make a statement to our residents so that we're not collecting these taxes. What I would say is currently the money does flow from the payment in lieu of taxes. It flows into the general fund to $2.7 million, and that's quite a significant amount of money. And I think if we're talking about the needs, like investing in this, you can't just eliminate $27 million from the budget and think that you're going to be able to solve the problems. Frankly, I think that the funds could in fact be used for some cash payment of capital projects that are associated with the public utility, rather than the public utility having to take on debt and paying interest on that debt.
Well, some of us have already read that piece by Paul Goldman that basically pointed out how pilot, as it's known, was basically a way to charge the crap out of poor people. And so personally, I would like to see it abolished. But I have to give you credit, Parker, for at least, seeking legal opinions about that. I think that's where it ultimately ends, is that the state has to abolish the pilot before we can actually abolish the pilot ourselves. But I do think it needs to go. And I also believe that the question also dealt with the base water charge. And I do believe that it's a bit too high for our meter homes. It's close to $60 this year. And I think maybe we need to look at ways that we can reduce that so that people who don't have meters in their homes do not charge $200 per month on their water bills. That's more than their electric. And I don't think that's reasonable. And I think it would also help is if people are allowed to install rainwater collection systems on their homes, that way we can live in harmony with the earth and obtain the things we need to survive through nature instead of having to use artificial means.
Quickly, two things that we did on city council since I got elected. We actually lobbied the General Assembly. Senator Henry Marsh championed the bill so that the city could actually begin doing some water rate assistance for low-income residents. Some people wanted, frankly, just give a subsidy. And I said, it's not about the subsidy, it's about water efficiency and making sure that the devices that they have in their home are actually conserving water when they're used. And then secondly, we did pass a bill, and I think that it could be expanded, but we allowed for VCU to collect rainwater and use it to flush toilets so that they wouldn't be charged with wastewater fees from the same.
I mean, that's a good proposition. I like that, Parker, but the thing is, what about the people? Can the people install rainwater collection systems on their homes? And so that way, the way they don't need to use city water. They can just collect it directly from nature and be able to use it on their own terms.
Thank you. What is your opinion of waste collections in Richmond between police and citizens?
Well, for those who are know me well know that I have publicly stated that I would like to see, I would like to see us come to a point where we do not need police in the first place. And that's where it came back to my answer to the first question about us having to fight for a system that actually prioritizes people over profit. Because when you actually have that in place, then you won't need police in the first place. But I do believe that race relations in this city, they have taken better strides in the past couple of years than what I've seen in the past. But there are some subtle hidden bits of racism, but it's mainly from what I'm seeing, it's mainly from outside of city limits, because people within the city, they're making the point. They're starting to see exactly what it is, everything for what it is. And they're coming to their senses, and they really want to change things, and I'm hoping that things continue to move in that direction.
So, I think Richmond is actually doing a lot better than other places in the country. And I think that that's very proven with not just Chief Alfred Durkin, but previous chiefs. They have fully embraced community policing. This has been practiced in Richmond for at least 10 to 15 years now. It's something that's fairly new to the rest of the country. It's one of the reasons why our officers are getting recruited to go to other cities to help bring in this model. Chief Adetta Johnson, many of y'all might remember her, she's now down in Portsmouth. You know, we are losing some of our majors and some of our high-ranking police officers because they know how to deal with community policing, they know how to deal with race relationships. One of the big things that they have been modeling is, what does the demographic of the city look like? Make sure that the law enforcement officers replicate the demographics, right? We want to make sure that they're looking like the people that we're also policing. I think they've also done a remarkable job of going into the communities, going to the civic association meetings, and trying to bring uplifting public engagement. I mean, Chief Durkin bought a bounce house so that the police could start hosting activities for kids, so that the kids don't grow up fearing the police, but they see the police as somebody who's going to be a friend and bring them into something that they can enjoy.
Well, one of the things I definitely would have expressed my displeasure with the Richmond Police Department is that it seems like they've pushed out a lot of propaganda that's been favoring police instead of actually educating people about what their rights are. Like, for example, there was a forum that took place at Seventh-day Adventist Church on the Montigue Turnpike. You, Parker, were a parent. There was a question about what are people's rights when dealing with the police, when they are stopped by police, what are their rights? I did not hear the police say anything about your Fourth Amendment right to refuse an illegal search. I didn't hear anything from the police about your First Amendment right, defending your right to be able to argue with a police officer. What I heard was, you just got to be quiet and just comply with the plain language. Quickly rebut your first point, Mr. Agelasto, because you are a public official. You should know these things, and you should be standing up for the people on these issues. Whenever there's an incident of police brutality, you should not be allowing these media outlets to go all around and distort the narrative like that. Talk about how people how this person who was shot by a police officer was a criminal or a thug or something like that. You should be the person standing up and be like, oh, well, this person was a human being. This person had rights. Why were his rights violated? You know, and it goes further to things like what's going on in the city jail. How many times How many times has Richmond City Council actually called for an investigation into the activities of the Richmond Justice Center?
Because that was your second rebuttal, and I'll give you 30 seconds as well.
Thank you. Now, going to the media, I'm not aware of much of these media events where they're reporting on police brutality in the city of Richmond. Not exactly sure. Nobody's contacting me saying that the police have brutalized them. And I think that people should go to their elected officials if there is concerns for that. But I will say just briefly, there was a victim of a police shooting within a block and a half from my house. And I went and I spoke with the family of the victim. They said it was a justifiable shooting. The person shot at the officer and was running towards them. I mean, these are the issues that officers are dealing with. You've got to get both sides of the story when you're dealing with these types of situations.
I understand, gentlemen, we can go on for hours.
It's a very
important issue. Can we get some questions from the audience? I'm going to go back to schools one more time. We've obviously been talking for a while about the possibility of some school closures. So one of our audience members has asked, they asked about a specific school, but let's just talk about some of the school closures. How would you guys address the issue of the possibility of having to close some more schools in the city of Richmond? And this time we will begin with Parker.
So I'll just leave this off. My wife started her teaching career at Maymont Elementary School, and it was closed. She transferred to Clark Springs Elementary School, and it was closed. Our wife had taught at two more schools. She's now at the Burns Elementary School in Houston, right there. We have dealt with school closing conversations ever since I got on the city council, and it is definitely one of these situations that I think is very much on the minds of our families. But here's the reality. The school board makes these decisions. The school board has approved something known as Option 5 that talks about a comprehensive evaluation of our schools. Where are we going to be making the investments? Where do new schools need to be built? Where do schools need to be added on to? I support the school board in passing Option 5, but at the same time, when you're talking about school closings, which Option 5 considers, it has to be done with a significant lead time. It doesn't happen in a well, it's going to close next year. We need to give families 2 to 3 years to understand that this is happening so that they can plan accordingly. You don't just start uprooting families in the schools that they go to. I think Option 5 is good. I think that the city council and the mayor needs to get behind it and fund it because that's going to be the way that we make proper investment in our public schools.
Well, the problem I have with that is the fact that the city has allowed schools to deteriorate to the condition it's had. By continuing to defer maintenance, basically year after year after year after year, and yet they have not, and it seems like every time the question comes up of whether we fix the schools or not, it seems to be put on the back burner for things like the Stones Brewery deal. And so I think that's, like I said earlier, it's all about prioritizing and valuing what human life over profit. Do we invest in these schools so that they can be in the pristine condition that they need to be, so that kids can learn, so that they are not infested with mold and mildew, so that these kids are not coming to schools with metal detectors and police presence, so that they can actually learn in an environment that actually gives them the presumption of innocence, like they rightfully should, so that they can excel in life. And that's what I'm not seeing from the city government in the past 4 years.
I think we can be a little bit more creative in how we address some of the problems in schools. We're a very historic school building here. It's over 100 years old. And yet the state historic tax credit program is ineligible to be used for this building because it's owned by a school board, it's owned by a city government. And yet if this were made private, the developers could get 40% of their investment costs refunded to them through tax credits. We also need to be smarter. Look at the windows. You can see that there are window units in these. There are such things called performance agreement contracts. Basically, we can work with the firm to come in and do a lot of energy upgrades and replacing windows in some of these units, and that can come at an extended period of time based on the energy savings that a building gets.
But see, when it comes to exactly what you're talking about, it seems like they're investing in certain schools. They're not investing in those kind of upgrades for Armstrong, for example, where I graduated from in 2006. They're now talking about doing the same for Summer Hill or Woodville Elementary. They're basically trying to focus on schools like this one and Thomas Jefferson and basically any school that is not located in a majority black area of the city. Well, as everybody knows, I'm Montigue Magruder on the ballot. My name will be Montigue T. Magruder, if you choose to vote for me. I am a person who has a proven track record of standing up for the people who we consider in society the least of us. I've worked on the GRTC and Transit Study Task Force, along with two of the mayoral candidates, what used to be three until Bruce Tyler stepped down. And I also served on the executive board of the Industrial Workers of the World, which is a labor union that has fought to organize minimum wage workers and even people in the prisons who are being exploited for their labor by the state. And so with my track record, I want to continue that track record and by being on city council, by being the person that actually stands up for the people that we consider the least of us in this city. Because for far too long, this city for the past 8 years has continued to prioritize the desires of the wealthy individuals and corporations over the quality of human life for the people that actually live here and pay taxes here. So I want to be the person that represents the people that live in public housing, the people that live in trailer parks, the people that take the bus every day, the people that actually work minimum wage jobs and are still struggling to get by. I want to be the person that represents them and make sure that their voices are heard on city council by city council.
So I'm asking your vote for re-election largely because I got into this because I wanted to help people. I saw that the city had a real need. I saw that the district was in a position to do a lot better if it had good leadership, good representation. It needed a partner, somebody that could collaborate, somebody that could listen, somebody that could understand the issues and bring solutions to the table, somebody that would be persistent if you couldn't get a solution immediately to keep trying for new solutions. That's why I started to run 4 years ago. I still think that we're not there yet. I think that we still have a lot of a ways to go in the city of Richmond. My wife said, "You really think it's going to change?" And I said, "Yes, we're going to have a new mayor. And frankly, there's going to be four new members of city council regardless of the outcome of this election. I think there needs to be some experience on the city council. I think there needs to be people who have the strong relationships, not just within the district, but also outside of the district. I have served on the Regional Planning District Commission. I have served on the Regional Transportation Organization. I'm the vice chair of the Richmond Region Tourism Board. I mean, I'm practically in all the regional conversations that there are. And I think at this stage, people have said,